Well, welcome to our Wednesday morning devotions. We're again looking at the number five and recognizing that five is often a symbolic number and a way of structuring the material that we find within Scripture. And what we're doing this week is we're looking at the first five books of the Old Testament, the Pentateuch or the Torah, as it would be known within Judaism. This morning, we're going to continue that journey as we've been doing over these last 2 days, from Genesis through to Exodus to Leviticus to Numbers and to Deuteronomy. And this morning, we're going to think about Leviticus.
Leviticus chapter 1. The Lord called to Moses and spoke to him from the tent of meeting. He said, "Speak to the Israelites and say to them, when anyone among you brings an offering to the Lord, bring as your offering an animal from either the herd or the flock. If the offering is a burnt offering from the herd, you are to offer a male without defect. You must present it at the entrance to the tent of meeting, so that it will be acceptable to the Lord. You are to lay your hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it will be accepted on your behalf to make atonement for you. You are to slaughter the young bull before the Lord, and then Aaron's sons, the priests, shall bring the blood and splash it against the sides of the altar at the entrance to the tent of meeting. You are to skin the burnt offering and cut it into pieces. The sons of Aaron, the priest, are to put fire on the altar and arrange wood on the fire. Then Aaron's sons, the priests, shall arrange the pieces, including the head and the fat, on the wood that is burning on the altar. You are to wash the internal organs and the legs with water, and the priest is to burn all of it on the altar. It is a burnt offering, a food offering, an aroma pleasing to the Lord."
Again, the name Leviticus is derived from its Hebrew, and it simply means, and he called. It's the third book of the Torah, the Pentateuch, and the third book, of course, within our Old Testament. Most of its chapters consist of Yahweh's speeches to Moses, and the way that Yahweh commands Moses to repeat his message to the Israelite nation. In Leviticus, God calls the Israelites and their priests, the Levites, and tells them how to make offerings and worship that is going to be conducted in and around the holy tent sanctuary, or the tabernacle, as we know it better. Leviticus is set within the month, or a month and a half, between the completion of the tabernacle, which we read about in Exodus chapter 40, and the Israelites' departure from Sinai. And of course, the instructions which are given in Leviticus talk about rituals and a legal framework, some moral practices, some issues about health and so on, sin offerings and guilt offerings, the means to provide a sense of forgiveness for the sins and purification processes for those things that have gone wrong in the life of the nation. So it's birthed around the tabernacle. It's a book about the way that the tabernacle is increasingly becoming the central place, as the temple will later on, of the Jewish nation. I guess an awful lot of people who try to read the Bible from cover to cover get as far as Leviticus, and then they begin to lose the will to live. If they bravely battle on, as I'm sure some do, they're going to get to Numbers, and by then it's all over. And of course, that's because simply the Bible doesn't work that way. The last three books of the Pentateuch contain the most amazing things for us, but probably we need to hang out with other scriptures first before venturing to discover some of their hidden treasures. As I say, Leviticus literally means in Hebrew, "and he called." Here we find God calling his people to a new expression of faith and worship. Here we see God calling his people to live in a way that reflects their love for him and their desire to live together as God's people. Here we see God calling a people to better practices in terms of moral behavior and how to keep healthy and well. And taking up that theme this morning, I wonder if we could ask that question. What is God calling to us today? What is he calling? What is he saying to us? Do we need to find and discover new expressions of worship and faith? Has it all become very predictable and ordinary and everyday for us? Do we need to deepen our love for God and our love for those around us? Do we need to hear his call to a better standard of morality in our behavior and our lifestyle? Do we need to hear his call to a more healthy and more environmentally positive way of life? What is it that God is calling to us to this morning? To the nation of Israel, it was to center their life around the tabernacle and to express their worship. I wonder what God is calling us to center our lives around at this time and how we're going to bring about those changes in our hearts and in our minds and in our spirits.
You gave a song for our souls to sing, and your life was the offering. Even death, it has lost its sting. Now we have forever,
and you can't take away what the world didn't get. We were made for more. We were made for more.